Maid has got a shade on, sweet Georgia Brown. Two left feet, but oh so neat, has sweet Georgia Brown. They all sigh and want to die for sweet Georgia Brown. I'll tell you why, and you know I don't lie, not much. It's been said that she knocks them dead when she lands in town. Since she came, why it's a shame how she cools them down. Fellas she can't get, must be fellas that she ain't met. Georgia claimed her, Georgia named her, sweet Georgia Brown.
Thank you. And if he doesn't stop, I will. Got a ukulele and a voice that's loud and shrill. And he lives next door to me, and he keeps me up till three with his ukulele and his funny melody. Crazy words, crazy tunes, all you'll ever hear him croon is vo-do-do-de-o, vo-do-do-de-o-de-do-de-do. Vo-do-do sits around all night long, and he sings the same words to every song with his vo-do-do-de-o, vo-do-do-de-o-do. His ukulele daily, how it drums, bum bum bum, vampin', stampin'. Then he hollers black bottom, crazy words and a crazy tune. He'll be driving me crazy soon with a vo-do-do-de-o, vo-do-do-de-o-do. There's a guy I'd like to kill, and if he doesn't stop, I will. Got a ukulele and a voice that's loud and shrill. And he lives next door to me, and he keeps me up till three with his ukulele and his funny melody. Crazy words, crazy tunes, all you'll ever hear him croon is vo-do-do-de-o, vo-do-do-de-o-de-do-de-do. Vo-do-do sits around all night long, and he sings the same words to every song with his vo-do-do-de-o, vo-do-do-de-o-do. His ukulele daily, how it drums, bum-bum-bum, vampin', stampin'. Then he hollers black bottom, crazy words and a crazy tune. He'll be driving me crazy soon with a vo-do-do-de-o, vo-do-do-de-o-do. Thank you.
Thank you. glad that we arrived in Australia. We had a very good trip on the way, except the last night when we were, pinched by thunderstorms and couldn't reach Melbourne. But anyhow, we arrived here a little later. I think everybody, especially the crowd in Albury, where we landed last night, for the assistance and all the help they gave us to get the plane out this morning again, out of the mud. Well, Mr. Moore, what do you think of
the... Oh, very wonderful.
I thought so too. Yes.
Who's there? Hume Weir. Hume Weir who? Hume Weir looking at now, of course. Oh, quit fooling. We're coming over all mathematical. Going to tell you all about this magnificent engineering feat which has just begun to pour the blessing of irrigation into three states, New South Wales, Victoria and South Australia. Work on this huge project began 17 years ago, and the three states and the Commonwealth have clubbed together and spent on it £5,550,000. Kindly provided by that gentleman who makes Santa Claus look a piker. We refer to the taxpayer. The huge concrete wall, more than 1,000 feet long, and the earthen embankments hold back at capacity 1.25 million acre feet of water. And what's an acre foot, Professor? An acre foot, my child, is an acre of water 1 foot deep. The building of Hume Weir meant the submerging of 33,000 acres of country. The township of Bowna, which was on the former Sydney-Melbourne highway, is now the only town in Australia where you can't get a drink after hours. It's now 20 feet under the surface. That water you see roaring through the needle valve isn't going to waste. It's going places. 14 or so irrigation areas. In New South Wales, it brings fertility to districts like Berequin, Wakool and Kurwa. In Victoria, it's carried to Cabuna, Swan Hill, Mildura and Mervyn. In South Australia, the water benefits Renmark, Chaffee, Waikerri. With the flow regulated and by a system of locks, it has made the River Murray navigable for 400 miles. All entirely drinkable, too, for those who drink water.
Albury, the borderland city, charmingly set in the midst of fertile plains and gently sloping hills. This town was the locale of one of the most monstrous crimes ever committed, the crime known as the Pajama Girl Murder. It was here on January the 18th, 1938, 3.5 years after the crime was committed, that the inquest was held, an inquest which was destined to leave this horrible murder as great a mystery as before. The coroner takes the bench and the first witness is called and sworn in. The man who found the charred and mutilated body of a pajama-clad woman lying beside a culvert along the Howlong Road. Breathless suspense gripped those present in the court while he gave his evidence. In a sincere and straightforward manner, he answered the questions put to him by the coroner. How did you come to discover the body? What did you do on finding it? And so we hear his story. On the morning of September the 1st, 1934, I was leading my bull along the grass at the side of the Howlong Road, and I stopped to light a cigarette. Then I noticed a peculiar-looking bundle lying beside the culvert, so I went over to investigate, and then I saw it, the half-burned body of a woman. For a minute, I was paralyzed with horror, and I got home as quickly as I could and telephoned the Albury police station. Such was this man's story, which within a few hours had made headlines in every newspaper in the Commonwealth. Then came the gruesome evidence of Detective McRae. Detective Cleaver's evidence was lost in the court, he having died 2 years before the date of the inquest. McRae told the court of the shocking state of the body when found, of the blood-stained towel and burnt sack in which it had been encased, of kerosene traces on the grass and culvert water. And then the dramatic statement. It is imperative that in the interests of justice, this woman's body should be preserved indefinitely. For if buried, identification would be impossible, and the person responsible for the murder could not be dealt with according to law. Excitement mounted higher as McRae continued his evidence. He, with other members of the department, had carefully examined the entire locality before removing the body. With the aid of the Albury government medical officer, they had carefully removed the towel and bag from the body. The legs and lower part of the trunk were badly burned. The kerosene found on the grass suggested that that spirit had been used for the purpose. The dead woman's face was shockingly battered and bruised, a gaping wound in the forehead. Then McRae gave his theory of what happened on the night of August 31st, 1934. Under cover of darkness, a car crept along the Howlong Road, pulling up not far from a lonely culvert. Stealthily, the figure of a man emerged carrying a heavy burden, the body of a murdered woman. On he came and placed his victim in a hollow by a drain 3 feet below the crown of the road. Then this fiend in human form saturated the body with kerosene, fired it, crept back to the car, and drove on into the night. Police had worked on the theory, and a hunt for the murderer had begun. Every clue was studied. These repeats of the actual pajamas worn by the murdered girl. This the selfsame towel taken from the battered head. In the corner of the towel, some lettering appeared, probably a laundry mark, possibly a private one and key to the dead girl's identity. But even infrared photography, a great probing agent, failed to reveal what those letters were. On the bag, the letters DALM over the words first grade were faintly visible. DALM was believed to be the commencement of the word Dalmore, the name of a farming district. These clues, however, shed no light. Hopes ended in the post-mortem, which revealed a compound fracture of the temple and forehead, 8 wounds above the left temple, and a deep gash caused by a blunt instrument. And then the unexpected finding, a bullet wound below the right eye, a bullet located in the neck. In pursuance of McRae's suggestion, the body was embalmed and taken to Sydney University, where it was placed in a formalin bath, a permanent, though slender, hope of identification. Hundreds of people anxious to help solve the crime have viewed the body, but with no result other than personal horror. For no one who has seen it once wants to see it again. The body of the girl had peculiarities. Large hands, peroxided hair, ears with little or no lobe. It was thought that these peculiarities must establish her identity. But disappointment followed disappointment. No one seems to have known the pajama girl. Artists drew their impressions. Police made masks. Photographs of each were published, but again without result. Then dental aid was called in. The teeth were extracted from the dead girl's head, and with these a cast was made. It was found that on one side of the mouth, the teeth were filled with amalgam, and on the other side with gold, a decidedly unusual combination. In spite of this, descriptions and photographs in the dental magazine brought no result. The detective's evidence went on to state how at this stage they played a thorough checkup on directories. Any young woman whose name was in a directory, not one single possibility was neglected, but again the quest seemed doomed to failure. The significant fact that the Commonwealth elections were held only a week after the finding of this woman's body led the police in 2 states to undertake the immense task of tracing every woman in New South Wales and Victoria between the ages of 21 and 35 who did not record her vote at those elections. Messages, photographs, circulars, letters were sent to all parts of the world. Woman aged 22 to 28 found murdered, height approximately 5 feet. Body well formed, peculiar ear formation, little if any lobe, no roll, bluish eyes, bleached hair, clad in pajamas of yellow and white kaby crepe of a not uncommon design with embroidered Chinese dragon running from top to bottom of coat. Can you place this woman? Back from the great cities and tiny outposts of the world came the reply. No untraced woman answering to your description is missing from this country. Thus, though all possible avenues were explored, the efforts of the police remained fruitless. There is an equal chance that the body of this woman was brought from another state to the position where it was found, or from anywhere in the state of New South Wales. Was it from your state that the body came? In the circumstances, the coroner's finding was the only one possible. Death from injuries to skull and brain, feloniously and maliciously inflicted by person or persons unknown. Did not give up, and on March the 27th, 1939, Superintendent Matthews, acting on information received, rushed Detective Wilkes, in charge of identification inquiries, to Albury. Again, the Howlong Road leaps into prominence. It was believed that a lake near Albury might possibly hold the clue to the Pajama Girl mystery. Fearing that the culprit might attempt to remove any incriminating evidence, the police stood guard at the lagoon all night until the Albury Fire Brigade arrived on the following morning, when the members of the brigade took their part in attempting to elucidate this four-year-old mystery. The large fire hose found a new use. Vast volumes of water were pumped from the lake until the muddy bed lay exposed. There was something in the lake. Once more, the culvert murder is front page news. Searching in the slimy bed of the lake, detectives found gum boots, shoes, slippers, blouse, and part of a silk dress, all of a size which could have been worn by the murdered girl. Stains on the dress blouse might have been blood. Were these the clothes worn by the pajama girl at the time of her death? Police believe that they may be. A peculiarity of the slippers and gum boots was that they were scarcely worn. Could there be any reason other than a sinister one for disposing of these perfectly sound articles? On the shelves of the silk manufacturers, a fabric was eventually found which resembled the material in the dress blouse. From this, experts have constructed a dress believed to be identical with that worn by the victim. Thus, with Detective Jardine's mask of the dead woman's features, a figure constructed from her body measurements, a replica of her dress and numerous drawings from police phones leading to identification of the woman. £1,000 for information leading to the arrest and conviction of the murderer. Or was it murder? Was the shooting an accident and the subsequent battering of the woman the results of panic? Somewhere in this great city may be someone who could solve this crime. Can you help? Or must the Pajama Girl murder remain forever one of the world's greatest unsolved mysteries?
The stars are tonight. I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you, dear. The moon may be high, but I can't see a thing in the sky, 'cause I only have eyes for you. I don't know if we're in a garden or on a crowded avenue. You are here, so am I. Maybe millions of people go by, but they all disappear from view. And I only have eyes for
baby face. You've got the cutest little baby face. There's not another one could take your place. Baby face, my poor heart is jumping. You sure have started something, baby face. I'm up in heaven when I'm in your fond embrace. I didn't need a shove, 'cause I just fell in love with your pretty baby face. Thank you.
built by Australian workmen at the Newport Railway workshops, the train embodies the most modern developments in railway construction. Air conditioning has banished drafts, flies, smuts, and excessive temperatures, while selected insulating materials have reduced train noises to an almost imperceptible minimum. And special gear has eliminated vibration even at the train's top speed of 70 miles per hour. The adoption of Corten steel for its construction also resulted in an appreciable reduction in weight with added strength and safety. More than 60 different occupations were represented at Newport among the workmen engaged on the construction of this magnificent train. Anglesmiths, car builders, carpenters, painters, welders, riveters, grinders, wood machinists, to mention only a few. Like other important Victorian trains, Spirit of Progress is fitted with automatic couplers which permitted the train moving as a compact unit and practically eliminate buffing shocks. Hauled by a streamlined Pacific locomotive, the train is suggestive of power, speed, and efficiency. An official launching ceremony preceded the inaugural run. Mr. Clapp, in introducing the Premier of Victoria, said, "This magnificent train has been produced entirely by Australian people in your railway workshops at Newport. The construction of this type of train is a very great step of pioneering in railroading in Australasia. I think you'd agree that it is a great achievement. It is not only the finest in the Southern Hemisphere, but it will rank with any of the great modern trains of the world." Mr. Dunstan, the Premier, in declaring the train open, said, "With the completion of this Corten steel streamlined air-conditioned express, Victoria will possess one, if not absolutely the best, of the finest passenger trains in the world. From the point of view of beauty, utility, and comfort, I have never seen it equal. I now have very much pleasure in christening this train Spirit of Progress." Mr. Dunstan then formally unlocked the door of the parlour car to the citizens of Australia. The ceremony created great interest, and a large crowd witnessed the departure of the train for Geelong. After the inaugural run, Spirit of Progress was placed on exhibition at Geelong, Ballarat, Castlemaine, Bendigo, and Spencer Street. Some idea of the tremendous interest it aroused is revealed from the fact that 56,000 people passed through the train during the 38 hours it was open for public inspection. Spirit of Progress ready to leave on its first trip to Albury on November 23, 1937. Another innovation in Australian railway travel was the appointment of a stewardess to provide all comfort services to women and children. The driver gives the motion gear a final drop of oil, the whistle sounds, the throttle is opened, and the train is off, and the never-ending task of firing starts in earnest. The smooth riding qualities of the train at speed are apparent from the very slight movement of the flowers in the lounge of the observation car. The armchairs and settees are upholstered in fawn, blue, and pastel green pinweave tapestry. The wall panels are of black wood and the carpet is rust-colored. The smoking saloon is popular, and large and comfortable easy chairs create a club-like effect. The wall panels are of Australian cedar. The streamlined blue and gold express provides an impressive spectacle when it is speeding non-stop between Melbourne and Albury with its large complement of passengers. Or, if you want a bird's eye view, here it is. Note how the smoke from the locomotive is deflected upwards. This train is but another example of the ever-improving service which the Victorian railways are offering to their patrons. Spirit of Progress, and no finer name could have been found for the pride of the Victorian railways, the greyhound of the tracks, and the last word in train construction in the Southern Hemisphere.
The largest storage of water on the Murray is the Hume Reservoir near Albury, where the Mittamitta meets the Murray. When the dam was built here, the imprisoned waters gradually rose and drowned many thousands of trees. When the level of the water in the dam is high, the excess pours over the spillway. Needle valves may also be opened and the required quantity allowed to flow through. Around Albury and Wodonga, there are rich cattle lands, and frequent sales of cattle and pigs are held.
Come from many countries in Europe and speak several different languages, men, women, and children, to a new adventure in this big, strange land so far from their own. This is Bona Gilla, a migrant reception center in Victoria, Australia, where they will stay for a while until jobs and more permanent accommodation can be found for them. They have travelled many thousands of miles to get here, over the sea in a ship, by train from the coast, and finally by bus from the station. They look tired and a little bewildered at first, but officers of the centre have prepared for their coming. They welcome them, talk to them, help them to find their baggage, and show them to their quarters. These three children, Marette, and her brothers Yuri and Yanni, are looking forward to a day of exploring the center and the countryside. As they move about the center, they will meet various people whom they will come to know better during their stay here. First, the policeman, who shows them the best way to go. Bang goes the gun. It's sports day at the center's primary school. There are races to be run, and parents to applaud, and teachers to organize and help. There are games to be played, and generally a lot of fun to be had by all. On the way home to lunch, our three youngsters pause to look at the enclosed kindergarten, where the very small children of the centre are left by their busy mothers to play with toys and games, especially chosen and provided, and are cared for by a trained kindergarten teacher. Then they stop to watch some older people, intent upon the ancient game of bowls, on the smooth lawn of the center's bowling green. Every section of the center has its own kitchen and dining rooms, Here the cooks have been preparing lunch for the many hundreds to be fed in this one. Afterwards, the staff will clear away and begin preparations for the evening meal. The children join their mother and the other members of the family at the table. Their excursions of the morning have given them a good appetite, but as they eat, they have much to tell her of the plains and of the farm and the people they have met. After a day which has been full of new and exciting experiences, the children set off for a final visit to the cool lake nearby, in the charge of some of the older girls and boys. In Indian file they walk, the tall, the short, the big, and the little, coming from different countries with different customs and traditions, but all unconsciously feeling a companionship in this new adventure.
Help the states to tackle this urgent problem. The Australian government's first move was to establish the Cities Commission to investigate and report to it on matters relating to urban and regional development. The first Commonwealth state action in this field began at Albury-Wodonga, when the Prime Minister and the Premiers of New South Wales and Victoria got together and decided that the Albury-Wodonga area should be the site of a growth centre, planned by the joint efforts of the three governments to foster an area already showing signs of a healthy expansion. Albury-Wodonga is a versatile primary producing area and a major servicing and distribution centre. It has ready access to a good and plentiful water supply and many natural attractions which are reflected in its strong tourist industry. Its situation on the major communication route between Sydney and Melbourne and on the banks of the Murray made it a natural choice. The district was first discovered by white men in November 1824 when the explorers Hume and Hoddle reached the river which they named the Hume, now known as the Murray. The little town that grew up there flourished and became an important centre. The first town plan was laid out in 1839 by a surveyor called Townsend. It was decided to call the town Albury after one of the three English towns of that name, perhaps this one in Surrey, which has remained almost unaltered till the present day. The Australian Albury, however, has changed enormously in the meantime. Chairman of the Albury-Wodonga Development Corporation is Mr. Gordon Craig.
The Development Corporation has been established by the Australian, New South Wales and Victorian governments to build a new city to be based on the existing cities of Albury and Wodonga. The three governments have come together as a cooperative venture to ensure that there is a living condition provided here that is second to none in Australia. We're going to provide an alternative to living in the suburbs of Sydney and Melbourne. We're going to pick up the problems that are apparent, that are obvious in the old cities, and we're going to make sure that these are not repeated here.
Any community needs an ample supply of pure water, and Albury is very fortunate in having the Hume Reservoir, one of the largest man-made lakes in Australia, which holds more water than Sydney Harbour. The first stage of the Great Dam Wall was completed in 1936. It now holds back the water from the catchment area of about 1.5 million hectares. One of the men who helped to build it is Tom Doran, a popular local identity. Tom owns the little country store of Wallinga, near Albury Airport.
Actually, the Hume Reservoir was built by manual labour, pick and shovel, bent back, sweat, blood and tears. That's what it was like. We did have some steam machines. We had a few locos, a few drag lines, steam. But most of the labour was pick and shovel, horse and dray. It was really brutal conditions. It was a bent back, and we had to jar that rock right out of the bottom with jackhammers, crowbars, picks, angelic night. It was very hard. The only thing that wasn't there were the chains. We had no chains on our legs. But we did have an economic chain, because if we didn't work, there was a row of men on the bank that took our job in 5 minutes. I'd go up the ladder sacked, and the unemployed chap had come down the ladder to start.
Second only to the water supply in importance is the selection and purchase of land needed for development. And a lot of care and thought has gone into the negotiations. It was realised at the outset that speculation in the land to be acquired would be bound to occur unless firm steps were taken to prevent it. So the states passed legislation ensuring that the land would be acquired at a fair market price, excluding any special increase due to the decision to develop the area.
Well, what are the ones that you require first will do first, Brian?
These people down here have already produced independent valuations, so when you can produce yours, we'll be able to start the negotiations. Now, once we get out of the priority areas, of course, we've got some other areas back down here.
There's
about three separate properties in there.
Down on the flat.
That's right, and then coming back up the hill there.
Yeah. It's steep, isn't it?
That's right.
Of course, not everyone in the community is satisfied that the development plan is a good thing. You can't satisfy everyone. But no one will be able to say that the development scheme has gone forward without due care and preparation. The task force is a team of able and enthusiastic men and women who work like demons.
Some growth forecasting study, a series of minor studies relating to the existing town centres and to systems housing, and a major water resources study aimed at assessing the impact of urban development on the headwaters of the Murray.
We've narrowed the range of alternatives quite considerably at this point, and we're now looking at the major physical elements in the city, such as the north-south transportation route, crossings over the River Murray, the kind of public transport system that we might have and the route that that might take, the sort of arterial and local road system and how that would fit the landscape, and also the location of major uses such as commercial centres, institutional uses, and the location of the major open space system and how that would relate to the Kiewa River, the River Murray, Lake Hume. We have a very dramatic site here, and we're attempting to fit all of these elements as sympathetically as possible to such.
This is planning for the future. But because of those qualities that led to its selection as a growth centre, the district has already attracted big firms who are nearly all expanding their operations. The manager of Borg Warner's is enthusiastic about the area.
We came here after carrying out studies on all the possible sites that we could build a modern plant on, because we found that in this area, it was the most attractive situation in which to start a large operation, for many obvious reasons. We brought with us 25 key personnel and their families from Sydney when we first started. And to my knowledge, I don't think any one of them would want to go back there to live. The air here is clear and free from pollution. There's plenty of scope for recreation in wonderful country. We think this part of the world is going to thrive. We already have over 700 people employed here with us, and we'd expect that to be 1,000 by 1975.
The manager of Uncle Ben's is equally enthusiastic about the attractions of Albury-Wodonga.
I should say that when you look at Sydney and Melbourne, and we looked at it in 64, it was already apparent that these two cities are strangling themselves. We looked at Penrith, for instance, and a very cursory drive from Sydney down Parramatta Road to Penrith will explain very easily why we didn't locate in that part of the world.
Many other big firms are building their factories here. In addition to good road and rail communications, Albury has an airport with regular services to the capital cities. Good schools at all levels are available for the children, and there will be a university by 1978. Kids still swim in the river where their fathers and mothers swam. But there is also a choice of three Olympic pools for those who prefer them. There are other pools which are very popular at the Trout Farm, which is a local and tourist attraction. Though they may buy trout at the farm, most fishermen prefer to catch their own. And there is an angler's club on the reservoir, which is known locally as Lake Hume. The Albury Yacht Club races several classes of boats there. The old town of Telangata was submerged after the dam was constructed. An attractive new town of the same name has been built a few miles away. But the old graveyard remains on the hill. There is another unusual graveyard in the district at Beechworth, where many Chinese used to work on the goldfields when the town was one of the greatest gold-producing centres in Australia. Over 4 million ounces of gold passed through this little building between 1852 and 1856. Beechworth today is a charming little town in the hills, about 40 kilometres from Albury. The old jail has had some famous guests, including the bushranger Ned Kelly. The Kerolo at Wodonga is one of the many old houses of interest in the district. The Hermitage on the Rutherglen Road is another reminder of the region's history and the need to protect it. And so is Olive Hills. Some have fallen into decay, like Fairfield. But they will be renovated. A root disease of vines, phylloxera, ruined many vineyards in the last century. But wineries are now being reopened, as is this one at Mount Ophir. Today, measures are being taken to avoid the spread of plant diseases. There is a rigid prohibition against taking any fruit across the border from New South Wales into Victoria. The two states combine to ensure that fruit fly checks stop infected fruit going into areas still unaffected. Locals may apply for roadblock passes. The government's agreed that in the development of the growth centre, the essential quality of the two cities must be preserved. They are proud of their litter-free streets, and they intend to keep them that way. Thank you. courthouse looks almost exactly as it did when it was built over a century ago. There are first-class botanical gardens just opposite the base hospital. The civic centres of both Albury and Wodonga provide fine examples of modern public buildings. Although Wodonga is smaller than Albury, it is a busy and thriving town in lovely surroundings. In Albury, older houses are set among trees. The newer houses, whose trees have yet to grow, are attractive and well constructed, and building is going on apace. All sporting facilities are excellent and popular. For people who like something different, there's pistol shooting. Against the background of the old winery at Mount Ophir, the redcoats of the Murray Valley Hunt strike a faintly alien note. But the riders seem to get a lot of fun out of it. And what's more, they don't kill any foxes. Another character who gets a lot of fun out of life is Alf Wright, who runs the minute Dora Dora pub on the Gingellic Road.
How are you? Welcome to Dora Dora.
Hey, Grimes.
Hey, Max. What's going on today?
Mark a few lamps.
Where are you, Alf?
Coming.
Where the hell are you, babe?
Oh, I went out to shoot a sawtooth mugwump. He's been worrying me for a day or two there, and I just got him now. I think I've got him.
Yeah, just the one.
There you go.
Not bad.
But,
Stealth, how many hats you got?
Oh, I've got a good few. Well, I can go from any sort of hat you like. I got, you remember old Spofforth, the old cricketer?
Who?
Spofforth, cricketer. Oh.
Not
at all.
Is that his
head? How do you like that? You know, the old bones.
Almost as well known as the Dora Dora pub, but considerably more decorous, is the Anvil Art Centre in the lovely Kiwa Valley. Art lovers come from near and far to see the collections and purchase pictures.
Isn't it a Billy Stockman?
It's a beauty. It's a marvellous painting, isn't it? Beautiful.
Isn't it
wonderful? Music is another of the arts which is favored.
Thank you.
The Civic Center in Albury is host to many visiting artists. This concert is being given by the Sydney Symphony Orchestra. The future twin city of Albury-Wodonga will be the first of a series of growth centres that will reverse the present one-way movement from the country to cities on the coast, and in so doing, provide a valid alternative to capital city living. Albury-Wodonga will be truly a city in the country, a city with its past history preserved, its present character maintained, and the quality of its future assured.